Okay, so today I'm going to be recommending some sci-fi and fantasy books that I think are good starting points if you're new to the genre, intimidated by some of these big hefty books. These are books that are really accessible, really fun to read, and that I think are a good starting place. I have 4 sci-fi books, 4 fantasy, and 1 that kind of falls into both, and I also have 2 videos that I've done this before. So the first video is actually only fantasy for beginners, and then I did another video a little while later, sci-fi and fantasy for beginners, and now, because I've read more books, I'm expanding on this list with yet another video. Both of those other videos will be linked down in the description in case you want, you know, more of these recommendations. This video will all be books that I've read here in the last year since the last video, so, you know, they're all decently recent reads, but I won't be repeating anything from my old videos, so, you know, you can still go check those out for even more recommendations. But first, before we get into this list, a shout out to today's sponsor, Squarespace. From websites to online stores to marketing tools to analytics, Squarespace is an all-in-one platform that helps you to build your website and grow your business. But we'll talk more about them at the end of the video. First book on this list is going to be Sword of Kygon. So this is actually a self-published book and I enjoyed it so much. It was really different from what I'm used to reading. The structure of the story was different, and the emotions that I went through, it was a very good book. So we follow the Kyganese Empire, who are master fighters, wielders of the sea, have had a land of peace for a while, but then this new threat comes in and kind of shakes that up and disturbs what they know. So we follow Mamoru, who is having to rise up and fight and figure out how to defend his people, as well as having a lot of concepts challenged and a lot of the way he views the political structure and the world structure that he knows, he sees it a little bit differently. And then we also follow Misaki, who is my favorite character of the book, she's an incredible fighter. We saw her in her youth when she was learning to fight and rising up, and now she is in a familial position. She's put her swords away. She is being a good wife and a good mother. But when this new threat rises, a lot of things are challenged by a lot of people. This is a story that has a really slow start, so I guess you have to deal with that, but that I thought was really unique, something different from what I've read before. And it's a story that challenges a lot of ideals, a story that forces people to grow and to learn and to fight back, and a story that is absolutely devastating to read at times, a really, really emotional one, and one that, again, just has a different story structure than what I'm used to reading. And a lot of it felt really fresh, and it's a story that has really stuck with me. And other than the very slow beginning, I think that it's such an easy and fast story to read, also with a magic system that isn't too complex, doesn't take over the story in any way, that I think is really digestible. For sci-fi, I have The Calculating Stars. This is a story, I think it takes place in the 50s. It's about female astronauts. The Lady Astronauts is the series name. So we follow our main character as she is in this training and as she's fighting to be able to have this position alongside these other women. There's a lot of personal and societal conflict, as well as a lot of our main character fighting for this position that she wants. It featured a marriage that I just really enjoyed reading about. I don't read a lot of books where the main character is already married, and it's a healthy marriage, and they're supporting each other and like working together for this goal. It's both of these characters are very, very smart, and they make smart decisions, and man, I appreciate that in my books, because too many characters get into predicaments based off of their stupidity, and I really like reading from the perspective of someone that is intelligent, making intelligent decisions, and the conflicts are external instead of the character causing their own conflicts by their impulsive behaviors. This is a really fast-paced, quick, I think it has a pretty light tone while still taking on some really heavy topics, or rather, some really, it's some very yeah, heavy. Heavy is fine. It has a very hopeful tone all throughout it, and it is super accessible, very easy to read. Next fantasy book is The Ember Blade. So The Ember Blade follows two best friends, Aaron and Cade, who find themselves in a very tough situation as they have been, I mean, it's the very beginning of the book and it's in the description. They're put in this work camp that is tearing them down and they have to find their way out of it. And then they have around them a fellowship, a band of people, and they're on this quest, on this journey to get to the Ember Blade. So this feels very much like a classic fantasy. It's very reminiscent of The Lord of the Rings. The author, Chris Wooding, does not try at all to hide his inspiration that is The Lord of the Rings, but it is a story that stands on its own. It's a very classic feeling story. It does a lot of things that we're used to seeing, but it does it in a really fresh way. It feels like a classic, but with a modern take. And I just enjoyed it so much. I'm a huge fan of The Lord of the Rings, and The Ember Blade just felt like a love letter to The Lord of the Rings, and maybe that's why I fell for it so hard. I'm so excited for book two. It's very accessible. The Lord of the Rings, I would not call a good book for a beginner into fantasy. And I think that The Ember Blade is one that is very accessible, very easy to read, just so fun all the way through and extremely digestible. So I really recommend it. I loved it so much. Next sci-fi book is 112263. So this is a story about a man who kind of stumbles on realizing that there is a way to get back to a particular event in history that he wants to stop from happening. This time travel story it's very contemporary in that it's kind of like a slice of life throughout a lot of the story. It's very, I would not call this a fast-paced book at all. It's very much about discussing what this character has to give up, what he would be sacrificing in order to try to change the events in history, as well as really fighting against the concept that the past is obdurate, fighting against the concept that the past is stubborn and unchangeable, and each time our character tries to change the past, tries to change history, when he returns back to the present, he finds that it changes major things. Even the slightest changes make a big difference. And so it's him repeating this time change over and over again, trying to not mess with past in the wrong way and trying to do what his mission is, but at the same time, falling in love with the past and having to make great sacrifices in order to try to accomplish this thing. Like I said, it's a very slice of life kind of time travel story, which is why I think that it fits into this list, which is why I think that it is very accessible and easy for beginners, because it feels like contemporary at times and it feels like a thriller at times, but it very rarely feels like science fiction. The time travel element of this is well explained, but it's also used as a tool of the story, not the story is the time travel. I mean, the entire plot is wrapped around the time travel. But I hope you know what I mean. Next book on this list is Six Sacred Swords. So this is another self-published book, and this is a book, I actually had this author on another one of these lists. This book is following a character who is trying to get to a particular sentient sword, and he has to go through a lot of obstacles to get there, including a talking dragon who is just the most lovely and hilarious character, and he eventually does get to the sword, and it's also lovely and hilarious. The story itself is very lighthearted and humorous and very fast-paced and generally just very fun to read. I laughed all throughout it. It's a lot more lighthearted than the fantasy that I normally read, but it was such a fun story to read. It's one that does not have complex magic systems. It's not one that has a big, vast, expansive world. It's pretty narrow in scope, at least for this first book, and was very, very easy to just breeze right through. Next sci-fi book on this list is Project Hail Mary, which I just put up a review for yesterday, so check that out if you want a really in-depth, spoiler-free chat about it. But Project Hail Mary is a story about a man. Well, we start off with him in space. He wakes up and he is in space, but he doesn't know why he's here. He doesn't know how he got here, and he really can't remember anything about who he is. And his memory starts returning to him in pieces, which means that we have two POVs. We have a present POV, and we have him, the snippets of his past that we get of his past life, and then of the conflict of this novel, how he got involved in it, and eventually, finally, how we got here. This was such a fun read. Again, it's a really lighthearted story. There's so much humor all throughout this novel that makes the more scientific story that we're reading, as well as the more sometimes very intense scenes, everything just feels fun, which was lovely to read. I think that this is a story where, again, it's a sci-fi novel and it's really grounded in science, but the author extends beyond that, and there's a lot of what if, though. What if this led us here? And even those what ifs are grounded in science. What would this scientifically look like? The science of it, I would say that this is the most complex and the most science-y sci-fi novel that I have here, but Andy Weir has such an accessible way of writing his sci-fi where even the science that went way over my head that I could not follow, I never lost the plot and I never lost the characters. Andy Weir did such a good job of making such a smart novel that is also extremely accessible and funny and just a delight to read. The final fantasy book on this list is Theft of Swords. That's right, every single fantasy book on this list has either sword or blade in the title. So Theft of Swords is, this is a bind up of two books because this was, again, it was initially self-published, but it got picked up by a publisher. It was initially six books. The publisher picked it up and mashed two books together and it turned it into a trilogy. So Theft of Swords is the first two books, but it's also one book. So much fun to explain that. And the first book in this book follows these people who are master thieves and swindlers. They are thieves for hire. They usually really think through the kind of jobs that they take on, and you know, they're very strategic. But this time, a deal that was too good to be true fell into their laps, and it was too good to be true. So we have this kind of heist that goes sideways and everything that goes from there. This book definitely does have its flaws. It's pretty info dumpy in the beginning, and the world really isn't expanded on much in the beginning. It's a very slow expansion, but I will say that while I really love a very immersive world, so the world not being built up very much in the beginning was a flaw to me. I think for beginners, this could actually be a really great thing because we focus a lot more on the characters and the action and the fun, exciting plot, and then the world building comes very slowly and organically, so it doesn't feel overwhelming at first. It just feels like a fun ride. And then all of a sudden you've kind of stumbled into this fantasy world that is a little bit bigger than it looked in the beginning. I enjoyed the first book in this book, and the second book in this book I loved. So I've only read Theft of Swords, which is the first two books, but it's the first book. I've only read Theft of Swords, and I really, really enjoyed it, especially there at the end was so great, and I will be continuing on with the series, and I think that it's so accessible, fun, exciting, with some very intense themes and very intense scenes as well. It's just, it was a great story. The final sci-fi book on this list is Kindred by Octavia E. Butler. This is my first Butler book. This follows I think she's 26-year-old black woman in the 70s who stumbles into time travel. She just gets pulled back into the 1500s? What was it? No, it was 1815. She gets pulled back into 1815. She doesn't know why she's here. She doesn't know what she's doing here. She has no supplies. She's also a black woman in 1815 with no free papers or anything that goes along with that. So she has the fear of the time. She has a lot of, like, you know, malaria, getting sick in this time and having to deal with the doctors of this time, what kind of food she's going to eat. She has to think about all those kinds of things, as well as the societal issues that she has to think about and be wary of and figure out how to survive in. So This one is probably the slowest of the books on this list that I'm recommending. This is one that is also very, well, slowest. I talked about 11-22-63 in this list. It's not the slowest. This book is also very much a slice of life. We're really focusing on our main character and on the struggles that she's facing and the fears that she's combating and having to survive in more than we're dealing with time travel. So the time travel, again, is more of a tool to tell the story and less of the science of time travel is the focus here. But I still thought that the sci-fi element of it, while it's more wibbly-wobbly, was so fun because she can't control it. She's being pulled back into the past by no control of herself, with no warning. Well, there is a little bit of warning, but not really. And then she's stuck here and she doesn't know how long she's going to be stuck here. She can't get herself out. At least at first, it seems like she can't get herself out. She has to figure out how to survive here and she doesn't know how long she's stuck here. And each time she is ripped back to the past, she's staying longer and longer and longer. And then she'll get ripped back to the present, but she doesn't know how much time she has left here to be here before she's going to be pulled right back again. And this back and forth and this tension and there's a connection here. There's a reason she's being pulled back, but she has to figure it out. It's a very slow-paced story, but I just found it so gripping, like every element of it so gripping from start to finish. Finally ending this video on A Natural History of Dragons, which is another book that I reviewed with Project Hail Mary yesterday. So this is a sci-fi fantasy. It follows a main character who basically feels like a Jane Austen character set in a Jane Austen setting, but dragons. And she wants to explore dragons. Dragons are kind of just a part of this world. They're not these mythical creatures. They're something that's here. There's something that people have accepted and know about, but that are very dangerous. Some of them are. And at this point, she just wants to be a naturalist. She wants to study them. And so this first story follows her, as well as her husband and a few others, on their very first expedition of exploring and discovering dragons. It has much more of a scientific and a studying approach instead of this mythical, fantastical approach, which was just so unique, and it's something I've never read before. I'm so attached to our main character. I love the writing of the story. I love the setting, and I love this very different approach towards dragons. Again, check out that review. I spend a lot more time really breaking down like what's great about this story and talking about it more in depth, but still spoiler free. And now an ad for Squarespace.
Here you go, darling. I made you a sandwich.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
Hey, do you want a little bit of advice?
No, I don't.
Okay, but if you did want advice.
I don't. I really don't.
Sure, but if you did, I would just say that maybe you could cook it a little bit less. Well, it's burnt. You gave me two knives. If you're tired of unsolicited advice, I have some more for you. Your website sucks, but it could be better with Squarespace. Squarespace has powerful blogging tools to share your posts, photos, videos, and updates. Categorize, share, and schedule your posts to make your content work for you. They also have integrated analytics so you can refine your email strategy with real-time campaign and website analytics from one source. Learn what content leads to higher engagement, tracking metrics from send to sale. So head over to squarespace.com for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, use the link in my description for 10% off your first website or domain. Don't let your website suck. Use Squarespace. There you go. That is a list of sci-fi and fantasy books that I think are great if you're just getting into the genres, if you're trying to dip your toes in, if you're kind of intimidated by the more complex, big, vast worlds or complex sort of things that come with these genres. I think that these are all very, very accessible, and I hope that you will enjoy them if you pick any of them up. If you haven't read any of these, but now you plan to, I'd love to continue discussing them with you in the comments. I post videos every Tuesday through Friday. I'll see you again soon. Bye.